morning, everyone. How is everybody today? I'm sorry for everybody for looking for a pastor. He's not here today. You got me. I'm one of his sons, where you see all the other sons getting trained up to be. But I came through this ministry many, 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 many moons ago. And God has been, many moons ago. And God has been faithful through my shortcomings and through my upcomings. And I just want to encourage everybody, don't look at where you're at. Look at where you can become. Because God has a plan and a future for each and everyone if you do one thing, cooperate. Cooperation is vital. Matter of fact, it can make a choice from you to make it home or not make it home. Because we have to abide by the rules that he has set standards for us to go by. And if we don't go by those standards, then we cannot become the way that he wants us to be formed as he's doing to us on that potter wheel. Anybody have felt the potter wheel before? Nobody felt the potter wheel before being when that thing is just forming and the waters, the anointing's coming, the water just coming on you, then the fire comes and trying to burn out that impurity in you. And then when you just wiggle one way wrong, and God said, nope, I got to stamp it. Got to do it all over again, because you're not coming to the fit and the form that I want you to be. Anybody been in them circles? Or I'm the only one? Huh? Anybody have come through the shortcomings? Yeah. Remember that. When you're being tested, when it seems like it's something small, that's where we stumble at. It's that small stuff. You know, they had a book out way back in the 80s called Don't Sweat the, no, 90s, Don't Sweat the Small Stuff. Anybody remember that? Yeah. How many times you get aggravated over the small stuff? And tomorrow is not even important. It's not even important. But it weighed so much burden because a voice came and determined that that was so important that you had to be there and did that when God said, that's not me. That's not me. Give me that. Give me that. But God, that's too small for you. You don't care about that. I care about everything and decision that you make. Because Satan wants to be a part of every plan in your life, don't he? So does God. He wants to be a part of every decision we make. And sometimes we struggle in those areas. Because we don't think that God can handle those little areas that's so not important to us, but they're important to him. All right, so we're going to talk today about the kingdom within you. That's the topic today, the kingdom within you. Which kingdom are we representing? Which kingdom are we glorifying? Through what we do in our decisions and our choices and everything. What is expression through our mouth when we don't even know that we're speaking? Because what you practice, you become. So if you practice eating the Word of God, you'll be speaking the Word of God no matter what kind of drama comes for you, because you'll stop your mouth from speaking and think about it before you express it. Amen? Is everybody okay? Is everybody looking at me like I'm crazy? Are y'all looking for a pastor guy? I'm sorry he's not here. But the Holy Spirit is here to express to you something that you need. Don't think that he left us. He said he'll never leave us or forsake us, right? So that means he's going to do what needs to be done in this service. Amen? Amen? Amen. So let's, first of all, I want to say something that God was flooding me with information while I was sleeping. I said, I don't have a pen, and you flooding this while I'm sleeping? And I wake up, and I'm like, man. He said, I'll bring it to you later. But, man, anybody had that when you wanted to tell somebody something, and you got all the information, then when you get to them, But that's how he works with and me at times. So the Lord was reminding me about something about Lucifer. When he was in heaven, he was in the kingdom, wasn't he? Amen. He was doing the bid of the kingdom. He was the praise and worship leader of the universe. He was doing what God asked him to do, and he had control over a certain amount of angels. And when he was on the earth, he had kingdoms down here, and they worshiped God. And the earth was God's footstool. Well, something got inside Satan and got beside himself. He got caught up with his insecurity. He started thinking that he needed to do more than what God asked him to do. And so that he tried to take what? The kingdom of God, didn't he? He tried to take what God ordained for all of them, and he wanted to rule over it. So God had to force him out, didn't he? Because the kingdom is taken by what? Force. And when he forced him out, he came down like lightning down to this earth. And then when he came down here, and then we were created, he had to find an access to come back to have a kingdom. So he worked hard to manipulate Eve, because you know every time Eve passed by, he was always trying to holler at her. Amen. Amen? He was trying to holler at her, right? And he got her attention one day, right? How many, the females know what I'm saying when I'm talking about hollering at, because they hear these guys in this world always trying to, come here, let me talk to you. Well, that was what Satan was doing. He was trying to express his character to her to touch and agree with what he had. And that was deception and darkness. And so when she ate of it, it became in her, but nothing was vital until Adam ate of that fruit, because God instructed Adam about it. And when he instructed, guess what? There was another kingdom that was expressed through him. By when he ate of that fruit, darkness came to expose itself, and light was separated from him. So we're going to talk about some things about the kingdom, where we need to have the kingdom within us so we don't allow Satan to take part of the light that we're supposed to express with our lives. Amen. Are y'all going to go this journey with me?
Amen.
Amen? Okay, let's go to Mark 1, 14. The first thing we need to do when we get to the expression of the kingdom, it says here in Mark 1, 14, it says, "Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. And believe in the gospel.'" So the first thing we have to do is believe. Because it's right here. When he says at hand, that means it's here now. So wherever we meet God at, and we come to the place of repentance, that's when the kingdom of God has a place to enter in. Because it comes through repentance, and it comes to have to believe. If you don't have true repentance on it, then it might seem like the kingdom is there, but it's a falsehood of that kingdom. Because I'm going to show you in the scriptures where when the expression of the kingdom is supposed to show, it's not showing. Let's go to Romans 12. How many of y'all know that when you look into on television or in the news and everything else, how many lies and deception are out there now? I'm talking about when you got to go and look at a movie. You got to go through all the horror movies that they got out now and all the fornication that's out there and everything else just to find a good movie. Back in the day, used to be a lot of good movies. Today, what seems good is evil. Amen. To the world. We have to fight just to find something to please what we need to watch. Because the world is made out of a whole bunch of deception. And a lot of people are being deceived. And we are supposed to be the light bearer to show them that that deception is not real. Amen? So Romans 12:1 says, "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies in a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be what? Conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Every day we give ourselves unto the Lord. That means we don't have a life, but a supernatural life. We have an eternal life. Don't be conformed to worldly lust. Be like Jesus, who is looking for himself. That's what he's looking for. Pastor always tells us, Jesus is looking for who? Jesus and us. Right? So your thoughts dictate your actions. We are being tested if we are following the mind of the world or we're following the mind of Christ. So when you make decisions, when there's decisions to be made, you're going to be tested. Are you going to follow my voice? Or are you going to follow the voice of the world? Because God is, this is where relationship comes in. Because God is going to be right there, you know, like David said, he's always before me. So he's going to always be saying, oh, what you going to, sometimes he'll challenge you and say, so what you going to do with this? Well, I think I'm going to do it my way. How many times we have done that? I mean, we shoot that voice out, and we heard that voice that tried to reason with us. But we push it out the way because our flesh is too stronger than our spirit. And our spirit, man, don't have the power to make the flesh to submit to the will of God. Let's move on to 1 Corinthians 2. This is going to be a short, quick teaching. No, seriously. No, seriously. Short, quick teaching, that's all. We're going to teach about things that we already should already know. And, you know, like playing sports, sometimes we get so good that then when we start making mistakes and playing sports, we have to go back to the discipline, the basic discipline. So we're going back to some basic discipline so that we can sharpen our tools so that when the enemy do try to come in and we can get them. Get them good. Amen? 2 Corinthians 2, verse 9. 1 Corinthians, I'm sorry. And that's pastor doing it to me. Yes, I'm blaming him. I've been underneath his rule. I've been underneath his authority for so long. You become just like him, you know? A lot of people don't know that, but you hanging around a certain person so long, you start becoming like that person. And you don't even realize it. You start speaking like that person. You start thinking like that person. You start seeing like that person. Because when I came in here, I came in with blinders on. How many of us came in here with blinders? And then as we came with the word of truth expressing to us over and over, and he speaks the same word over and over again. And you're just wondering, are they going to get it yet? See, I miss them. That's what I'm going to have to talk about, because I miss him. I miss his leadership. I miss his love. I miss the character that he shows us to carry. You know, he does a good example. Sometimes he falls short, but guess what? He's a man. But he shows that character. He practiced that thing daily and hoping that we can catch hold to it so that we can show others when they come in, others that we express on the outside, and others that is in the family. How many of us need to express the character of Christ within our family? Even when they don't think that we have that character because they're still looking for the old man. Amen? Amen? Right. Okay, verse 9. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who loved him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches what? All things. Yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man except the spirit of the man, which is in him. Even so, no one knows the thing of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man speak wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who spiritually judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. So many lose sight and get complacent and go back to the world. If you don't have fellowship with the Spirit of God, how will you know the deep things of God? That means you have to have his character to express to understand the deep things of God. You have to go through some stuff. I mean, if you don't go through the stuff that he's trying to bring you through, not the stuff that you put yourself through, but the stuff that God's bringing you through to test you with so he can bring value to you. Amen? The unbeliever are swayed by false promises of man. They believe that they done did their duty already. So when they do duty for the Lord, they think they completed it. But the word says, commit your works unto the Lord, and then your thoughts will be established. So if we're working for the Lord, we're always looking at the Lord, how can we do this? Show us how to do this, Lord. Show us how to do this. So then when it's completed, guess who gets the glory out of it? God gets the glory. Because that's who we work for. We work for a higher kingdom. We're ambassadors to that kingdom. So when our actions expresses, it's supposed to express the kingdom of God. Not how we feel. Because our feelings lie to us, don't they? That gives in, how many times you say something and you have to shake your head like, man, God, can I take that back? and it's too late because it already went out. And you're trying to grab it back. Sometimes I'll be ready to say something. I go, oh! I have to repent because the thought that came. The thought was there, but I didn't allow it to have the power to come out my mouth. So I repent for the thought so it could dissipate so the light can take out that darkness. Amen? Isaiah 11. Oh, man, we are challenged daily. We are challenged daily. Every time you turn around, there's a challenge right there before you. Even when you do good deeds, you're challenged. Because in your good deed, you're challenged not to let pride get in. Because Satan will say, man, look at you. You done did a good job. And you go, ka-ka-da-da-da! Look what I did. He does that. And we don't even realize it because we come from darkness. And we have to practice these things so that we realize that we're not allowing the enemy to sway us underneath his rule. Underneath his rule. Okay, Isaiah 11, verse, where are we going? Verse 1. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of fear of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is Christ. We're supposed to stay filled in the Holy Spirit. These characters that he expressed, that he speaks about Jesus, are supposed to be in us. So as we see these spirits that express knowledge, wisdom, discernment, and everything else that goes along with that, we're supposed to express the same characters. We're supposed to work those things out, and we have to practice them until we become them. You know, people say, fake it till you make it. But really, you're supposed to faith it till you make it. Put the faith there. Activate the faith. Then you have to fake it. You just faith it. And then you can make it. Because sometimes you can fake it and you won't make it. You're acting. But you activate faith, you can make it. Because it'll bring the hope. Then you can receive the promise. Because then you'll learn the word, so you become the word. Then you have fellowship with the word, and it'll become in you. It says, I have here, it says, so you can walk in the, let me repeat that. Spirit of the Lord is Christ. Stay filled in the Holy Spirit. So you can walk in the natural and stay in a full state to death to self. God wants to impart in us, and we want to become one with Him. So that we can get that connection. That connection. That connection. So when we're connected with Him, now He's the battery. Matter of fact, He's the energy. He's just the pure energy. He ain't no battery. He's the energy. Period. And then the cables come down to us to be connected to us. And we get the charge. Praise and worship. Charge it up. And then as we express, the fire of God comes out of us to touch others. Now they can get connected. And then that express the domino effects to others to get connected. Let's go to Ezekiel 11 while we're over in this area. He's the power source. He's the power of God. We need Him. We need Him mightily. And when we don't think we need Him, we need Him more. We need Him more. Got a question. Have anybody ever been through some pain in their life? Some pain that you think that God cannot come into? And we blame God because of the pain? Come on, we all wasn't all saved all of our lives. How many times we have blamed God through that pain? Why you allow this to happen to me? Not knowing that God was going to use that pain to bring it into joy. He was there. He was there when we was going through the suffering. He was there. But He had something waiting for us. Remember when we talked about the transfiguration of changing? See, when you change, what God is going to use is what you, the damage that happened to you in the world, He's going to turn it around for His good, for His glory. He's going to get glorified out of that. See, Satan tried his best when he had us in the world. Every person in this place is supposed to have been dead. Because if Satan had his way, we will be dead right now. But because God's hand on us, He protected us when it seemed like we was not protected. So that we can get to the place that He had a new day for us, a new way for us. And all we had to do was tap in to receive it. Remember in the beginning, you had to believe. You had to believe that it was possible. Yes, for you. I hear some voice. Now, ain't it for me? No, it's for you too. For each and everybody that's in here, it's available for service. Remember, God serves us, doesn't He? He raised the sun every day, don't He? He raised the moon every day. He rains on the ground for us, don't He? He rains the food for us, don't He? He serves us every day. And that's how we're supposed to learn how to serve for others. And get past ourselves and our selfish selves and put Him first. Because the kingdom of God is within us, isn't it? Where are we going? Ezekiel 11, verse 17. It says here, therefore say, thus says the Lord God, I will gather you from the people, assemble you from the countries where you have been, scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. And they will go there, and they will take away all the detestable things and all the abomination from there. Well, we got rid of one abomination, didn't we? Yes. If you know what I'm talking about. Then I will give them one heart, and I'll put a new spirit within them, and take the stony heart out of their flesh, and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statute and keep my judgment, and do them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. But as for those whose heart follow the desires of their detestable things and their abomination, I will recompense their deeds on their own heads, says the Lord our God. Never come in agreement with your soul or flesh. Never come in agreement with your soul or flesh, because that's your mind, will, and your emotion. Don't let that rule you. Don't let it rule you. Stay in commune with your spirit, being connected with the Holy Spirit, so that your spirit man can speak to you, and then it can rule your soul. Now, verse 18 and 19, he took them away because it was affecting their hearts. What we choose to agree with, our flesh, it will obey. God will cause your flesh to submit to him, for his will, not our own. That's what he's going to try to, that's what he's going to try to do to you, because we have to cooperate to submit to him. You know, the word says, submit to God, resist the devil, and what will happen? He will flee from you. But we have to do our part by submitting so that we can create an atmosphere that surrounds us wherever we go. So that where we stand at, the kingdom of heaven is in us right where we stand at. It could be hell ringing loose around you, but the kingdom of God is right there where you're standing at. And you have the answer to give to somebody that's going through it, then you're able to express the character and let it go through. As long as you stay in the will of God and let him ordain you where you're supposed to be at. Because sometimes we're making our own will and it's not God's will. Is there, everybody got that? A lot of times we're making our own will and it's not whose? God's will. We choose, because what happens? We're making our own choices and going before him instead of going with him. The kingdom of God is supposed to be within us, right? So we're supposed to be carrying the kingdom wherever we go at, but he's supposed to lead us. He's supposed to lead us where we need to go, not telling him where we need to go. Everybody looking at me like I got three heads. Is this a strange language to you? This is something that we ought to know and be accepted, because even when we make our mistakes and shortcomings, we're supposed to repent to the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me. I made some wrong choices. Help correct me in these areas. Because I made a bad choice. And I allowed damage to come into my own house. I'm struggling because I made the choices of those struggles. And I didn't allow him to. And then when he brings the correction, I refused it. Because it was coming against my flesh. It was coming against my will. It was coming against my hopes instead of coming to his hopes, his will, his plan, his desires. Romans 14. The kingdom of God within you. Romans 14, verse 15. The word says, yet if your brother is grieved because of your food, you are no longer walking in love. Do not destroy with your food the one for whom Christ died. You know what the food he's talking about, right? The words. The words that you eat, that's the food. He says, therefore, do not let your good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who serves Christ and these things is acceptable to God and approved by men. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one many edify another. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for the man who eats with what? Offense. It is good neither to eat meat nor drink wine, nor do anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. Do you have faith? Yeah. Do you have faith? Have it to yourself before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself and what he approves. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats because he does not eat from faith. For whatever is not from faith is sin. Because one thing about faith is, that's the only thing that can please God. It's not by our works or what we do. Because all that stuff is temporary. All that stuff is going to fade away. It's by your faith. It's by what you're going. When God puts something before you, and it feels like it's not the right thing to be put before you, because God's going to put something before you that you don't like, are you going to hold on to the faith and just deal with it anyhow? Amen. Or are you going to holler, scream, and just fight to have your way? Because that's not the way the kingdom of God expresses itself. The kingdom of God expresses itself through love, peace, joy, righteousness, and the Holy Spirit. That means that you have to deny yourself, put a muzzle over your mouth. Because sometimes it's hard. But God said, be doers of the words. That means he didn't say, let's just try this thing. He said, do this thing. Then it will become the kingdom. Without you doing it, your faith has no action. It has no expression. And people are looking for something that's real. Because they already see all the fake stuff that's out there. There's a lot of phony, baloney stuff going on out in that world right now that people are not seeing genuine. The things of old where the disciples were walking into. You got to remember, the disciples didn't have the power of God until Jesus said, I will bring you a comforter. That comforter is here today. That gave us the power to fight temptation, the power to fight the things that will cause us to fall short, the power to overcome, the power to control our tongue, the power of the way we see things. I wrote down here the dynamic of Christian life and ministry is found in understanding the kingdom of God. You have to understand the kingdom of God before you do anything else. Which is not eating and drinking. That is the ritual and performances. But rather it is in righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's the only way that you can express his character, is through how you express how you go through trauma. Anybody have a trauma in their life? You know what trauma is? Something that comes to you unexpectedly and you don't even realize it, and it shocks the waves out you. And now, what's going to happen when that happens? Are you going to fall back onto how you feel? Or are you going to come to the place of trusting and what he's already spoken, that's eternal? We have to believe. We have to build up. And another thing is, God's going to test you so he can build your faith up and make you stronger. We all started out with a little measure of faith, didn't we? Each and every one of us was given a little small measure of faith. And it's what we do with it that will bring that faith into bigger and better places. Because he said he'll bring us what? Faith to faith, glory to glory. That means as we practice it, we will get bigger in it and bigger in it. That's when pastors got bigger in faith because, yes, he had that Holy Ghost experience, but he still had to cooperate by faith. And by him practicing and being disciplined with it, I see him growing over years. I mean, changed over years. I remember the times when we used to tell us stuff back in the day. I know some people that have been here when I was here. And we've seen the character of him change for the good. And that's how God wants to see us to change in that and for the good. So that when people come back and see you, they'll say, man, you changed. And you don't even have to say nothing, but they can see it through the expression that you are portraying through others. Amen? Amen. Everybody okay? Amen. Let's look at Luke 17. Luke 17, verse 20. And the word says, now when he was asked by Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they say, see here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you. You see that? It's within you. So when people say, well, they doing something. No, I'm not going over there. I got the guy right here within me. He got me ordained to do what I need to do right here. I ain't moving. Until he tell me to move, I ain't moving. I got to stay right here, even if I got to die to myself to it. Even if I got to cry through it and chop my head off and everything else, I ain't moving. Because the kingdom of God is right here within me, and he expresses his character right here. He's doing something in me. He says he's doing the good work in me. I can't stop. He said he ain't going to leave or forsake me, so I got to keep on going. No matter how I feel. Because he's trying to bring something new. Something new. So I don't live out my soul, but I live out my spirit. When you are filled with the Spirit of God and walk in it, you receive his kingly rule. Not only in your life, and over your affairs, but through your life and by your service of love. Of love. Not like, but of love. That means you see somebody that needs help, you help them. It could be your enemy. You help them anyhow. Because love overcomes the fear that try to generate in you. Have you ever did a deed and you're trying to work and do stuff and fear's all around you, and you're trying to get through it, and fear's just keep on talking, and you're trying to overcome and do it, and the fear's always speaking until you complete it, then the fear just drops away. Yeah. It's only a voice. And when you have the power to overcome that fear, you can express the love of Christ. Because really, you're committing your works unto the Lord. So you're working for the Lord anyhow, so what does it matter? You're doing it for his kingdom anyhow. You're supposed to be expanding his kingdom so that others can come in and find him also through the love of Christ. Because that's how we found him, right? When we were falling away in sin, how did he get us? Through his love. Do you remember your first day when God touched you? Some of us was boo-hooing and crying. Some of us, we were so sorry in our sin that we didn't believe that he accepted us. Remember those days. All right, how about when you're in the shower and you shower and then he comes meet you? You can't move. And he just expressing his love all over you. And you come out and go, whew, what an experience. And there's other places he can catch you too. In the bathroom. And he'll deal with you. Because if you didn't get dealt with, he don't want to see you struggle. Because he won't give you a choice. He won't give you a choice. Either you do or you don't. Either you do or you don't. If you don't want to do it, then you'll meet him at the end. You know, the worst thing to find, you know, the worst person to meet is a person that lies a lot and they believe in it. They believe in their own lie because they've been tricked by the deception and don't even know the deception is still there. Amen. That happens to, and I'm going to tell you something, that happened to all of us. We say something and then we believe that, we cause ourselves to believe in it because we wanted to. Because the flesh was ruling instead of the spirit. Let's go on to Matthew 5. Matthew 5, verse 1. Is everybody okay?
Amen.
Okay. Matthew 5, verse 1. And now, and seeing the multitudes, and went up on the mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed. Now, this part right here, verse 3, is for those who need to be humble. It said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for there is the what? Kingdom of heaven. Can't get the kingdom of heaven in pride. You only can get the kingdom of heaven through humbleness. Let's go on. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. That's how come we're having a problem with this nation in the last few years. And evil had progress immediately in the last 8 years because we had evil in our White House. And it changed laws. It took ground. It took over territories. And we was not able to fight against those things because it came from the head on down. And God allowed that so we can practice to fight. He allowed that to happen. You remember, he allowed those to be in leadership. So if he allowed that to be in leadership, we had to practice to fight. Now it's time to take ground back because leadership has been restored in the right place. And that's how come we have so much chaos that's going on in the world. Isn't it strange that we got riots going on about people that is afraid of what's going to happen and they're doing it themselves? Anybody check out the news and see how twisted things are out there? We got people out there going crazy because a man got elected by the votes of the people and they're acting crazy because they didn't like the choice that's placed in office. Now, you got to remember that another person got a place in office 8 years ago. I didn't like the choice. But I ain't seen no riots going around and people destroying things and acting crazy. But people of God had to go in their prayer closet and fight. Now we have to fight to keep the rule of the nation to stay together. Because if it keep going like this, it's going to bring division. Because that's a house divided can what? They can't stand. And they got people that's elite people that's giving these people finances to do these things, and they don't really know what they're doing. They're just doing it because it's the way of the world. And they believe they need to be a part of it. And don't know that they're destroying their own homeland. And that's a shame. It's a shame. So we need this, we need to pray for this country more and more. So that God's will can expand to do the things. And as we go out, you got to remember, they're going to persecute us. They're going to persecute you for your goodwill. If you go out the streets where I go out, I see people all the time. And I see how they talk and what they do. I don't go to the good places. I go where the demons are at. Gotta go down to the clinics and everything else. And there's not good people down there. There's sick people. There's people that need healing down there. There need people that need deliverance. I see crazy people down there. People full of demons. And you know, and you have to have discernment. Should I speak to that person or not? Because if God didn't tell me to speak to that person, I'm not. I'm not going to get in a place that I have to back up my words and fight to try to bring somebody to salvation that don't want to be in salvation. But I allow the Holy Spirit to be strengthened so when that person that's available to come, I'm able to give. Because I don't want my peace to be taken away. Because you can get into a conversation, and next thing you know, you're mad. Trying to express Christ to a person. And this way, we got to remind ourselves to have discernment to keep the peace within you. Because it's your job. It's not your job without other people do. It's not your job without that. You can pray for them, but it's your job to keep the peace within yourself so you can overcome. Because you can't hear them if you got so many other things going on in your head. You can't hear that voice when anyone speaks to you. Because you'll nullify it. I'm sorry. Let's go. Let's move on to verse 6. Blessed are those who hungry and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are those the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for there is the... So when you're getting persecuted, where's the kingdom of heaven at? Within you. So anytime that things are not going the right way, guess where the persecution is at? It's in you. Because you got to understand something. When Jesus got on that cross, he never did no wrong. But the world persecuted him anyhow because of his good deeds. And without him seeing it through and said the last word, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they did. It will never have the place for the power of God to come to us to be able to say, Father, forgive them. Because we are the example of seeing Jesus seeing us in him. If we can't do that, then Jesus is not there. Because if you can't forgive, then there's no Christ. Because the anointing is supposed to break that yoke of bondage. Are we all there? Amen? Amen? So I put some things here. Verse 10, I have put here in verse 10, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for there is the kingdom of heaven. You're supposed to be willing to suffer. Suffering and persecution. You're supposed to be willing to do that, to go through the suffering. Supposed to be willing because he was willing to do it for us. Remember, God demonstrated his love towards us that while we were in sin, he died for us. So he was willing to do it even when we had a sinful nature. He thought about us. Verse 11, blessed are you that they revile and persecute you and say that all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Amen? Let's go to verse 20. No, I'm sorry. Let's go to Matthew 6. Matthew 6, verse 10. And here it is. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as is in heaven. Give us this day your daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Another thing that helps us with the expression of heaven being in us is through prayer. Because a lot of times we have to pray our way through. Because sometimes conditions happen. The only thing you can do is go to him because he's the only one that has the answer. Amen? I know this time that we have to go to the Lord and go to him and pray to him. And I'm not just talking about just praying to him with your normal tongue. But pray the perfect will to be manifest in you by using your gift. Even when it hurts and you're crying through, he sees that. He sees you suffering. He sees you fighting to fight for his will. He sees it. And that's all that's important, is that he sees it. Because that's who we work for. Matthew 6:33 says, let me get there. No, is there Matthew 6:33 or did I do that to myself again? Okay. But seek the first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added to you. That's the part that I'm talking about seeking. Seek after him. Seek after him when you don't feel like it. That's the best time. Because the devil's trying to tell your flesh, you ain't got to do it. Come on, man, let's go and do this. There's a time that we have to make a place to have reverence for God, even out of fellowship. Where nobody has to tell us. You just do it because you want to get closer to him. Amen? Because our daily days of the world, man, we get so busy that we forget about him. I got this list to do. I got to do this, do this, do this, do this. And we forget about him. And you know, sometimes you have to do it while you're working. Pray in tongues. You don't have to express it where everybody can hear you. He hears it when you mumble it. If you're around other people, you amen? So you can keep peace within yourself and peace with others. Amen? Hallelujah. Prioritizing spiritual over material. Yeah. We must prioritize spiritual things over material things. We have to prioritize that. Matthew 7. We're going to stay in Matthew for a minute. Matthew 7:21. Now everyone says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. We must acknowledge Christ's lordship by obeying the revealed will of God. We must practice his lordship because he is Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You ever seen the England when they come to the queen or the king? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. That's how we're supposed to respect God. I mean, when the king comes, they know that he got power in his hand and for life or death to kill them right then and then. So does he. Don't be concerned what man can do. Be concerned with the one that can take your soul and throw it to hell. Amen? Let's go to John 4. That's where relationship comes in. We got to have a relationship so that the kingdom of God can stay within us, expressed through us, and the characters can be about us. Character, character, character. Where's the character at? It's in your what?
Heart.
In your heart. In your heart. So where we stand at, Jesus is supposed to be dwelling right here. Because what comes out of the heart comes out of where? The mouth. But where does it first come through? The thoughts. The thoughts that come through. That's when we have to dress ourselves with the full armor of God each and every day. And sometimes two or three times a day. And you don't dress your own self. You ask him to dress you. Because he knows how to place each and every one in the right position to bring, to protect you. The helmet of salvation, he put that there to kill the fiery darts that come in. Now, one thing the Holy Spirit expressed to me, and I've never seen this before, the Holy Spirit is like a coffee filter. Yeah, a coffee filter. And you know how you want to get things purified, right? So when you put the water through and the expression comes through, the filter is supposed to hold away all the dirt, right? So that's when the thoughts come in. The Holy Spirit is right there to block that thing. So when the seed of the word comes through and the demon tries to attach to it, it's like, you ever seen the insect's light that every time an insect's coming here, bzz, bzz, that's what it's supposed to be doing to the demons that try to attach to the word. Bzz, bzz. So it cannot enter into the kingdom. So it'll die. So it has no place for an expression. Yeah, because you got to remember, it has power. There's power there. Everybody okay?
Amen.
Amen. That's what the Lord showed me this morning. You have to go into how I think. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is for the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshiper will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must," he ain't say maybe, "they must worship him in spirit and in truth." Amen? Let's go to Mark 16. Everybody should know this scripture. Famous scripture, Total Freedom. I remember when I first came, we used to have that scripture almost every teaching. He pounded that in our heads to let us know who we were. To let us know who we were and what character we're supposed to express as we go out. Mark 16:16 says, no, let's go 15. And he said to them, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature." That means everybody. I'm not even over there. He who believes is baptized will be saved, but those who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and they will drink anything deadly. It will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. One thing, like Pastor always said, what we need to do is first cast out the demon in us. Get that thing out of us. Get it out of us so that we can express the character of Christ to others and that the kingdom can show. Because, you know, there's all kinds of demons. There's sickness demons too, though, you know. Things that's temporary that come into us and everything. But the things that we have no power of, like our choices to choose, the things that we determine to speak, the things that we determine to do, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to work in us, to change us. Because we all fall short. Come on. Each and every person in this place will fall short when the Holy Spirit asks you to do something and you choose not to do it. Because because something came up, you got busy and you forgot about it. And you're like, oh, the Lord told me to do something. I forgot. And then what we have to do when we get to that place? Repent. So that the blood can come in and it'll kill the curse. It'll kill the curse. Because we don't want to have that curse on us. Amen? All right, Mark, 1 Timothy 4. And should be the last thing. How's everybody?
Blessed.
Amen. 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 Remember that when we leave here. Now, there's other scriptures that talk about the kingdom of God and everything. But today, I'm just going to do this expression because, you know, I can get long-winded and keep you here for a few hours. You know that, right? Amen. Those that know me know I can stay here for a while. But I'm going to, so I'm just going to give you partial of the things of the kingdom of God. And you do your research and let God show you where you need to meet with the kingdom of God and you to express more of his character to express through you to others. Plus this, so that you can get your tent pegs to go further out so he can bring you out more to do more available. Because trust is earned. Trust is earned. If he can't trust you, he can't put you in the place that he really wants to place you at. Because remember, don't determine where you're at today. Look to where he's going to be bringing you to. Because the day is already done. What I just spoke right now just passed away. It's just behind me. Where I'm at right now is my present. And what I'm about to speak is my future. So you have the ability to speak your future right now and keep hold to it. Amen? 1 Timothy 4. Verse 12 says, let no one deprive your youth, but an example to the believer in word and conduct and love and spirit and faith and purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of their eldership. Meditate these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to who? To all. So when you carry the kingdom of God to you, everybody can see it. The sinner can see it. Yeah, I ain't going to go over there. When you're such, man, he's full of the Holy Spirit. I ain't touch. I don't want to be bothered with that. He'll see it. Amen. It's his choice that he wants to come or not. But the expression of the character of Christ is there. What you practice, you ain't even got to fake it. You ain't even got to try to do it. You're doing it because it's in you. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Amen? Now, only way to get through, now, I want to tell you something. The only way to get through deception is with the truth of God. And that is his presence of God when you speak it. Because when the truth of God is in you and you speak it, his presence is there. Now, if you choose not to do that, deception will bring you delusion. It will bring you confusion. It will bring you compromise, complacency, and laziness. And most of all, it will bring you manipulation and fear. Amen. A person that walks in fear can't trust. Won't trust. They won't even know that they have fear because, like I said, the character of God is peace, joy, and righteousness and the Holy Spirit. If you cannot produce peace, that means it's not in you. If you can't produce love, it's not in you. If you cannot produce joy, it's not in you. One thing the word says, we're supposed to treat each other better than we treat the world. Because we are the body of Christ that the world is looking at. So we can't get together and get along with each other, then we not have, then the kingdom is not expressing the character because Jesus and the Holy Spirit and the Father, they all work as one and there's no competition in God. It's all one. So as we work together and do it as God ordained to be, then things can have a place where it can come through and have access. But God is looking for something that's touching the green with his spirit to come with our spirit. So that connection, man, you know, what's in here right now can change a nation. This right here, us in here can change a nation if we come in unity and oneness. Just like the fire that came into the upper room. There was only so many people in that upper room that changed the world. Because they came in oneness, one accord, and fires of tongues came upon them, and the expression of Christ came in them. Amen?
Amen.
So, with the deception, it brings the presence of evil. And we're supposed to be fighters against the presence of evil. So as we get our hearts and minds for communion, let's pray first. Father, we come together, Lord, and we thank you for your word and truth. Lord, I ask that as your word spoke through, Lord, that it will penetrate our hearts, our minds, and that anything that we have fallen short of, Lord, I pray that our hearts will be open to receive. And anything that rejects your truth, Lord, I ask that you will express it in the night season when we're asleep, that we can't do nothing about it. And that you reveal yourself to us so that your love will have a place in our being so that we will grow ground for your glory to give you honor and praise in Jesus' name.